Let us pray. God of mercy and compassion, it is good to give you thanks and praise because you continue to call us to share the fullness of life. Though we are sinners, you promise forgiveness, and through the incarnation of your Son, you've bond us to yourself in a new and unbreakable bond. You give to us this Lenten season a time to draw near to you on our journey. Open our hearts to your Spirit and respond to the needs of our neighbor. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. We call it for purity, Almighty God.
Thank you.
morning to everyone, and welcome St. Peter's Parish Church. Today is the third Sunday in Lent, and as we celebrate this third Sunday in Lent, we do so as we remember the life and witness of our sister Jenifer Yvette Hoyte. And this service is to commemorate her memory. She was buried yesterday morning at St. Andrew's Parish Church. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord.
Let light perpetual shine upon her.
May her soul and all the souls of the faithfully departed, to the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen.
Our service continues on page 101 after the opening sentence. Be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God.
Blessed be God, Father, Son,
and Holy Spirit. Let us again offer the prayer of intent. Blessed Lord and Father, we have assembled in your name. Let us pray. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ, O Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Let us together offer the Collect for Ash Wednesday, which is used throughout our Lenten period. Almighty and everlasting God, please be seated for the ministry of the word.
A reading from the book of Exodus, the third chapter, beginning at the first verse. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, I must turn aside and look at this great sight, and see why the bush is not burned up. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses! And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He said further, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I now know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He said, I will be with you. And this shall be the sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain. But Moses said to God, If I come to the Israelites and say to them, The God of your ancestors has sent me to you, and they ask me, What is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. He said further, Thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am has sent you. God also said to Moses, Thus you shall say to the Israelites, The Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever. This is my title for all generations. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the Word of God, written in the first letter of Paul the Apostle to the Corinthians, the 10th chapter, beginning at the first verse. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and all ate the spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them, and they were struck down in the wilderness. Now these things occurred as examples for us, so that we might not desert evil as they did. Do not become idolaters as some of them did. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink, and they rose up to play. We must not indulge in sexual immorality as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in a single day. We must not put Christ to the test as some of them did, and were destroyed by serpents. And do not complain as some of them did, and were destroyed by the destroyer. These things happened to them to serve as an example, and they were written down to instruct us on whom the ends of the ages have come. So if you think you are standing, watch out that you do not fall. No testing has overtaken you that is not common to everyone. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But with the testing, he will also provide a way out so that you may be able to endure it. The word of the Lord.
The gradual hymn, issued in modern 682, Awake Our Souls, Awake Our Fears.
No more.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke, the 13th chapter, beginning to read at the first verse. At that very time, there were some present who told Jesus about the Galileans, whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. He asked them, "Do you think that because these Galileans suffered in this way, they were worse sinners than all other Galileans? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish as they did. Or those 18 who were killed when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others living in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish just as they did." Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came looking for a fruit on it and found none. So he said to the gardener, "See here, for 3 years I have come looking for a fruit on this fig tree, and still I found none. Cut it down. Why should it be wasted in the soil?" He replied, "Sir, let it alone one more year until I dig around it and put manure on it. If it bears fruit next year, well and good. But if not, you can cut it down." This is the Gospel of Christ.
I speak to you in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Life bowls us some strange balls at times. And how many of us will have thought that we've been here this morning to say farewell and thank you to Jenifer Yvette Hoyte. We join in expressing thanks to Almighty God for the wonderful gift which he has given to you, the Hoyte family, and to the wider family, to her parents, to her siblings, to her daughters and grandchildren. And we were able to share many years in that wonderful gift. And perhaps by accident, because I remember the family saying to me, When they left St. Andrew many years ago, with two little children, they had choices. And somehow they found their way to St. Peter's Parish Church, and they made this their home ever since. God moves in a mysterious way. And God brings people together. And today he's brought us together in a very special way. Yvette Hoyte brought us together, has brought us together today. Persons from different walks of life. Her teachers, her friends, her family, and the church family. It was her wish to bring us together, not in a funeral service, but in a service of thanksgiving. And today we don't meet to cry or to mourn, but we meet to be happy and to be joyful in the name of Jesus, her Lord. And he was her God, and he is her God and our God. And we meet joyfully to give God thanks for the wonderful life that he shared with us and with you, the members of the family, for the many joys you experienced, the many times you sat down together in family, and the many things you've shared, and your quiet sharing of the pains of the last few weeks, and the knowledge of what was happening in her life, but yet the tremendous support she has given to you along the way. And I'm sure that you're thankful for all that she's done for you as she's guided you through this life. We give it to God, and we celebrate what God has given to us that no man can take from us. Her love, her patience, and her joy. Words from the Gospel this morning, St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 13, verse 8. He replied, "Sir, let it alone for one more year, until I dig around it and put manure on it. Sir, let it alone for one more year until I dig around it and put manure on it." I'm going to ask you to do something very different this morning. Take those words, "let it alone." Put them in your pocket for a little while until I get back to them. We think about "let it alone." Hold on to them. Traditionally, Lent is about forgiveness. And it's about putting things right in our lives, gaining a sense of perspective as we prepare for Easter, the joys of Easter. As we prepare for the cross and all that the cross signifies to us as God's people. Lent calls on us to be a mature people, to be people as we reflect. As we reflected over the last few weeks and the themes, Lent as a time of suffering, Lent, also today we think about Lent as a time of cleansing. Lent, a time of cleansing. And we hear those wonderful song, words of the song, "Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing blood? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?" Our God and Savior offers to us that washing, that cleansing power which comes from God Almighty. As we think of God who cleanses, we think of Jesus. When we think of this, we think of Jesus entering the temple. And he drives out those who bought and sold in the temple. And he says to them and he challenges them, "My house is a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of robbers." But the cleansing power of God goes beyond driving people out of the temple. And the cleansing power of God, which continues to renew our lives and renew us as God's people. God at work in our lives. The gospel reading just read this morning tells us a number of significant things as we think about God as cleansing. We think about two stories at the beginning that we so often gloss over. History does not tell us about this, but in the Gospel according to St. Luke, we have these two stories. One is about Pontius Pilate as Luke continues to introduce Pontius Pilate. And we know that he's going to play a significant part, not only in the life, but in the death of Jesus. But Luke tells us about the crisis which is brought in a nation because of the killing of persons by the soldiers. A tremendous wrong was done to these Galileans, and they were killed at the point of worship in the temple as they carried out the rituals of worshiping God. As they came to the end, as they were put to death, and the question is asked of Jesus, are those persons who were put to death worse than we were? Are they not as good as we are as people because they've suffered, because they've gone through all of this? And Jesus says, I tell you, no. I tell you, no. And then those who were close to him come to him with another story. It talks about the tall silo which was being built. The walls fell and killed 18 persons. And the question again is asked, were these people worse than other people that they were killing at that particular moment? And Jesus responds by saying to the crowds, by saying to them, I tell you, no. No, I tell you. Jesus points to something great, something more important. He points to the suffering which takes place in human life. The gospel reading reads to us like the news on CBC at night, Admiral. It reads like not only the news on CBC at night, but BBC News or CNN News, because it tells us about things which were supposedly happening in Palestine at a particular moment. We get an understanding of the various crises faced by people and the troubles faced by people as they went through and experienced their problems. As we too in our lives experience problems. As we too in life experience suffering and pain and death. As we look around and we see every day, every night, clips in our news of people suffering across the world. People suffering not only in our own country and the problems that people face with water. I can say and confess I've been bathing out of the bucket for the last 4 days. And I think about those persons who have been doing it for months in this country or years in this country with promises of having that being changed and things looking different for them. But we think about those in distant lands, not too distant. Those persons who are suffering, who have been driven away from their homes, persons who have lost their legs, persons who have lost and families who have been separated because of war. And we think about those persons in metropolitan countries near to us, who are experiencing problems within the inner cities. And we recognize their shock that there is suffering and pain. And a God who says to us, as we look at that suffering, a God who seeks to put us right and to show us a way forward. And he shows that he brings the best out of us. Read the epistle to the Corinthians this morning as the second lesson, where we hear St. Paul saying to the church at Corinth, God is faithful. He speaks of the faithful nature of God and the God who is there for us through all our pain and through all our sufferings. A God who helps us to make sense of even the worst of situations and to bring a sense of value and to hear him speaking to us in our lives. Here, we think about it as God who speaks within the context of the loss of a loved one. A God who speaks to us and he says to us, he's taken something of a treasure from us. Someone that you've treasured and loved for so many years. And someone who has given to you great love and care and understanding. But yet, not to be angry with God because God has taken her from us this day, but to look back and to appreciate what God has done for us through her witness and through her presence among us, that she will have made a difference in so many ways to our lives. A God who says to us, in Jesus, in the words in the gospel reading, as Jesus seeks to deal with the suffering placed before him, as he seeks to deal with this thing which is called death that we are experiencing now, a God who says, and he draws on a very simple illustration of the fig tree. And he says, there's a man who planted a vineyard and he placed in that vineyard a fig tree. And he came looking for fruit from that fig tree after 3 years. And there was none. That the fig tree was barren. It didn't produce. And his response was immediately, cut it down. Cut it down. Let's eliminate it. It's a waste of time. It's using up valuable space, taking up valuable space which can be used by other plants in the garden. And the gardener, the vine dresser, who says to him, don't worry to do it now. The vine dresser says, leave it alone, let it alone. Give it the opportunity to grow and mature. Give it another year before you take drastic action in removing it. And as we hear about this, it isn't going on, the story isn't going on to say whether or not it will have borne fruit after the year. If not, or it didn't go on to say that it was cut down or not. But the request by the vine dresser, the gardener, who is Jesus, leave it alone. And often in our lives, we who go through and we who experience problems in our life, we leave it alone. And why told you to take that phrase and put it in your pocket? I'm going to ask you to take it out now and bring it in focus, bring it in your minds, because relate it to what is happening to us now. Relate it to what is going on in your minds as family and friends of our sister Yvette. How many times she would have said to you and coined that phrase for us, leave it alone. The peacemaker that she was, who would have said to us, don't worry about that. Leave it alone. Let it go. How many times she would stood up and allow the ball to pass outside the off stump in cricket in terms to leave it alone. And one who brought this concept of life to reality, perhaps it is part of your teaching tradition. When persons write off your students in your classes, and when persons write off students in your schools, and you say just simply as principals or as teachers, leave them alone, give them an opportunity. We think about a God who gives opportunity, a God of opportunity, a God of forgiveness, a God of hope, a God who helps us to understand other people and how they think and what is going on in their lives. Today as we gather, we leave it alone also, because this is not our wish. Today is the wish of God, the desire of God, we let it alone. This service is the desire of Yvette Hoyte. This is the way she wanted us as a people to pay tribute to her. We give God thanks for the marvelous life that she has lived. And she showed us how to leave it alone, to allow things, don't get into fights and quarrels, to walk away. Although you know that in deep down inside your mind that you're right, to leave it alone. The peacemakers, a God in Christ Jesus who said to us, blessed are those, the peacemakers. Blessed are those individuals who bring peace to bear in human life and human situations. Here was an individual challenged in many ways, but left it alone peacefully. She submitted herself to God and saying also, leave it alone. Let God have and take his part. To recognize God at work in her life and to recognize the presence of God and what God was doing and how God had called her to a particular mission, and that mission now was ended. To leave it alone. To stand by her side. We thank Almighty God for those who stood by her side. For family, daughters, husband, and the extended family who stood with her. Those who cheered her on. In her quiet way, she bore her cross and bore her burdens. The teaching community will suffer her loss, even though retired, but will continue to make a sterling contribution to that community. The community of St. Andrew, the Church of St. Peter's, where she supported our young people in so many ways, in providing for them and giving them a wonderful example. But we think about her and her contribution to this church. She made an important contribution at the level of our daycare as co-chair of the daycare committee in this church. And she brought that level-headedness to it. She brought a feeling, a knowledge of education to it and dealing with children. And I was sat on many occasions, Saturday evenings, as we welcome our students into the day nursery and the parents. And how she would draw on her knowledge and her experience as a teacher and a principal of a school and to bring things down to the level of our parents. How she contributed quietly to the work and witness of this church and community. I remember with a sense of joy at her being wicked, and she being wicked, and Sunday morning sometimes trying to beat her getting here, especially during the summer months when the services are shorter and the mass is said, and Mrs. Hoyte could never get here at 9:15 for service, and to look up and see when she got here and say, Mrs. Hoyte is here. But when she had to be here, she was here to read her lessons. She did it with a sense of joy and privilege. It was her church. If she served her God, and she served her God well. And we give God thanks for the blessings that he has given to her. And we leave her alone today. She buried yesterday morning in the quiet way she wanted to be at the St. Andrew's Parish Church. We left her there. We left her alone. But we left her in the hands of a merciful Savior, a kind and loving God, the God she loved and the God she served to the end. And we know, although we felt and we know that there's loneliness in that part, in death, but yet we know there's rejoicing in being at home with Jesus, her Lord and Savior. We leave her alone. And to her family, to her husband, Michael, to her daughters, Karen and Maria, to her grandchildren, to her sisters and siblings, to her father and mother, it's a privilege to have parents alive at that age, but isn't it? To them, well done. We extend to you sincere condolences on behalf of the church community here at St. Peter's, on behalf of the parents and the attendants at the St. Peter's Daycare Committee, and all our organizations at St. Peter's, on behalf of the Parochial Church Council, and all our members, we extend to you our sincere condolences. We thank Almighty God for her witness, her presence among us. We thank Almighty God as the words of reception of the body say, and I did deliberately yesterday morning, veer from what I was told to do. We gave her yesterday a reception of the body. We gave her a commendation to God, her record, a message of commendation to God. And we gave her a committal to the safe hands of the God she loved and she served. May she find the peace and rest which is hers in Christ Jesus. And we say in the words of Jesus in St. Luke's Gospel this morning, the 13th chapter, the 8th verse, I tell you now, put it back in your pocket. Let it alone. Let it alone. God has done. God has spoken in a wonderful way. To a woman who loved dance, she loved music, she loved song, she loved creativity, and she loved drumming. To all the many activities she was engaged in, she did it with a sense of joy and privilege. And we pray that she finds that rest and peace with Jesus, her Lord and Savior, as we say, let her alone. Leave it alone, because God has the last say. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon her. May her soul and all the souls of the faithful departed to the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen.
The hymn 270, Come Down, O Love Divine.
Let us together confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Please kneel for the intercessory prayers.
Intercession Form B, found on page 111. Our Heavenly Father has promised to our Lord Jesus Christ to hear us when we pray in faith. Let us dare pray for the Church of the World, and let us thank God for his goodness. We pray for the Church of God in every place, especially for this diocese, our Bishop Michael, and all the people of God.
In the Church to carry forward the work of Christ, that we and all who confess your name may unite in truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory to the world.
We pray for our country and for all the nations of the world, especially the Ukraine, and for all peoples in their various callings.
Direct this nation and all nations in the ways of justice and truth. Give wisdom to all in positions of public trust and authority, that they may promote the prosperity, godliness, and peace of your people everywhere.
We pray for our own community, for this parish, for our families, friends, and all who live and work with us.
Give grace to all our friends and neighbors in Christ, that we may serve him in one another and grow together in his love.
We pray for the poor, the sick, the unemployed, the handicapped, and all who have requested our prayers, and all who seek the prayers of the Church in their time of trouble.
Give healing and strength to all who suffer in body, mind, and spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and sustain all those who remember and pray for them.
We commemorate the departed, especially our sister Jennifer.
We commend all people who are unfailing.
Accept these prayers, O Lord our God, for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. The Act of Penitence, found on page 123. St. John reminds us that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us, in a moment of silence, not just call our sins to mind,
But pray, Heavenly Father, will strengthen us to turn from those things which are not pleasing to him. Let us now together as a community of faith confess our sins. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and one another in thought, word, and deed. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We are the body of Christ, where the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, and have all been made to drink of the one Spirit. My brothers and sisters in Christ, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Seated. Pleasant good morning to everyone, and once again, welcome to St. Peter's Parish Church. Extend a welcome to the members of the Hoyte family, and please stand, and the other members of the family, Jenifer's parents, mother and dad, sisters, and the extended family, please stand. All who are here, Daddy Hoyte, please stand. Welcome to you. And other members, the sisters and the family, mother, dad, if you're here, please stand. Welcome to you. Welcome to everyone. To the members of the teaching fraternity who are here, her teachers, her friends, welcome to you. Please stand. That should be the whole church. Welcome to you. Welcome, and your faith continues to be tested. Please do remain strong and resilient as you not only face death, but you face life. May God be with you as you continue to lead our students in our classrooms. And to all other friends, a very warm welcome to you. I extend a welcome to my own sister who's here from Atlanta, Mrs. Heather Lehman. Please stand. Welcome to you. Nice having you with us, Heather. Familiar face. Any other visitors with us? Welcome to you. Birthday greetings to those who celebrate birthday greetings during the course of this week. Michelle Gibbons, Ethna Hinkson, Natalia Blades, And also anniversary greetings to Cardinal and Cindelin Spencer. Any of those persons here this morning? Thalia upstairs, happy birthday to you. Yes, Thalia, happy birthday to you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the joys of life. We thank you for enriching our life, for helping us to see the various conflicts in life, life and death, light and darkness, joy and peace. We ask you to be with us as we celebrate yet another occasion. As Thalia celebrates her birthday, be with her. Continue to give her strength, continue to direct her in doing your will. We ask these things in the precious name of Jesus, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. We sing happy birthday to Thalia. And to those who are watching the stream live, greetings to you as some of you celebrate your birthday during the course of this week. And welcome to St. Peter's as you share in worship with us, as we share not only in grief, but we share the joys of human life and happiness, how we support each other in times of crisis. Our services continue at 6 p.m. this evening with Evensong, and then tomorrow Parochial Church Council meeting online at 7 p.m. Parochial Church Council meeting 7 p.m. tomorrow. Tuesday, 6:30 p.m. online devotions. We're doing Stations of the Cross. We're doing Stations 5 and 6 this week. So we look forward to persons joining us on our Bible study on Stations of the Cross on Tuesday. Wednesday, midday devotions at the Spikestown Methodist Church. Next Sunday is the fourth Sunday in Lent, Mother and Sunday. Services at 7:30, 9:30 and 6 p.m. I shall also say that Friday this week I celebrate my 39th anniversary of ordination to the priesthood, and continue to pray for my ministry and my ministry here. We thank God for your help, your support during the years. We look forward to celebrating hopefully 40 years next year. The choir, we'll be having the Easter recital by the St. Peter's Parish Church Choir on the 24th of April in a month's time. We look forward to your support. Again, a very warm welcome to all. Oh, sorry, I've made a boo-boo. Welcome to the celebrant of the Eucharist this morning. All products from St. Peter, Father Davison Bourne. Welcome you, Father Davison, from St. Christopher. And welcome to Father Hugh Sandiford from the Church of St. Matthias. Gentlemen, your families, if they're here, welcome to you. I would like to say, we're happy to have you home. We're happy to have you celebrating with us, but we know that we prefer to have you in different circumstances, but we continue to ask for God's blessings on you, both in your ministries, and we thank God for your witness and your work. Yesterday morning at the burial, we were joined also by the rector of St. Philip's Parish Church, Father Trevor O'Neill. We thank him also for his participation. I pray God will continue to bless the family as they mourn the loss of Jenifer. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord, that light bright shore shine upon her. May the soul of all the souls of the faithfully departed, for the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. A number of housekeeping items. Please do remain in your place this morning. The collection plate will come to you so you can make your offerings. So please remain in your place this morning. And for communion is done at in the center of the church, center aisle. And we invite persons to social distance. Remember, you're 3 feet apart and you're moving to the outer aisles. If you're making communion, you're moving to the outer aisles and you're coming in at the center aisle. And remind you, please, to sanitize
First, the ushers will be there guiding you, so please sanitize as you come. And as we look towards the future, we look forward to celebrating Easter and Holy Week. We have on the carols a return to communion on both kinds via intinction for Holy Week, for Monday, Thursday, and for Palm Sunday and Easter, and hopefully we go on as things yet continue, we move back to communion of both kinds. Not today, but Easter, something to look forward to in Easter. Ascribe to the Lord the glory to his name, bring an offering and come to his courts with praise and thanksgiving.
The offertory hymn number 672.
Thank you.
us to get off the prayer for the presentation of the offerings. Father, we offer you these gifts which you have given us.
Cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that fervent in prayer and in works of mercy, and renewed by your word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Continue on page 135. Holy and gracious Father, all creation rightly gives you praise. All life, all holiness comes from you through your Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord, whom you sent to share human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. We therefore bring you these gifts. We ask you to make them holy by the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who offered himself in obedience to your will, the perfect sacrifice for all mankind. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it for the remembrance of me."
Let us proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Calling to mind the death your Son endured for our salvation, his glorious resurrection and ascension, his continual intercession for us in heaven, and looking for his coming again in glory, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and life-giving sacrifice. Look with favor on your church's offerings, and grant that we who eat and drink these holy gifts may be filled with your Holy Spirit and become one body in Christ and serve in unity, constancy, and peace. May he make us a perpetual offering to you and enable us in communion with Blessed Mary and the whole company of heaven to share in the inheritance of your saints. With him and in him and through him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father Almighty, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven in the songs of everlasting praise. As our Savior has taught us, so we pray. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Our souls with peace and satisfaction.
589, Hear, O my Lord, I see thee face to face.
Yeah.
though it is hard to work for God.
Thank you.
thank Almighty God for blessings received in this act of worship and for his grace he continues to bestow upon us. Let us now offer the first post-communion prayer. Let us pray together. Almighty Father, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we who share his body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We upon whom your Spirit shines give light to the world. Help us to continue in faithful witness to your word, so we and all your children shall be free and the whole earth live to praise your name. Christ, give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourself, take up your cross, and to follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you and those you love, this day and forever.
The recessional hymn number 310.
Amen.
Lord, support us all in the long this troublous life. Until the shades lengthen and the evening comes, the busy world is hushed and the fever of life is over and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant unto Jenifer Yvette, O Lord, and that light perpetual shine upon her. May her soul and all the souls of the faithful departed to the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen.